We are now in a position to take everything that we learned about the theory and practice of memory devices and actually set out to build chips that implement all this functionality. So Project 3 begins with all the chips that you designed in Projects 1 and 2, as well as a primitive data flip-flop that you can use as you see fit. And based on these building blocks, we have to build the following chips. We've seen all these chips in one way or another in the previous units, and now we actually implement them. Now, most of these chips, all of them except for the program counter, constitute a family of increasingly complicated sequential chips, beginning from a 1-bit register all the way to a RAM device that contains more or less 16,000 registers, 16K registers. So let us begin with the 1-bit register, whose diagram and documentation is repeated here. We've discussed it before. Here is the stub file. There's nothing special about it. And the implementation is something that Noam described in previous units. So you can just follow up what is written here and build this this chip in HDL. Moving along, we can take a set of such single-bit registers and build from it a 16-bit register. The HDL is shown here, and all you have to do is create the right wiring, and what you have is a 16-bit register. So now we are ready to move on and build our first RAM device consisting of 8 registers. Here is the API of this chip. Here is the stub file that describes its input and output pins. So now that we have all this information, let's figure out how we can actually build such a RAM device. So I can give you two very important tips. The first one is that you have to take the in value and feed it simultaneously to all 8 registers, so-called at the same time. So you use HDL statements to fan out this incoming value and send it to all the registers in the RAM device. And then you use some MUX and DMUX logic in order to select the exact register that you want to be affected by the respective read or write operation. So once again, you send the information to all the registers, but only one of them is going to be selected using this MUX and DMUX functionality. Now, I want to leave you the details because otherwise you won't be sufficiently challenged, I think. And with these details, you have everything that you need in order to build this this RAM device. Moving along, we have implemented the first 3 chips, and we are ready to construct the more elaborate RAM 64, 512, and so on chips in the hierarchy. So this is our next task, and here is how we do it. We start with the RAM chip that we just discussed, and we stack together 8 such RAM chips, and what comes out is, or what results is what we call a RAM 64. We can take 8 such RAM 64s, put them together to yield the next chip in our hierarchy, which is RAM 512. And we can do 2 more steps of a very similar nature and end up with the most elaborate RAM chip, the one that we have called RAM 16K. So we basically repeat the same, call it recursive ascent, if you will, and by using this this strategy, we can build more and more elaborate RAM chips. Now, how do we do it? Well, first of all, we note that a RAM device can be built by grouping together smaller RAM parts, which is, you know, an HDL description of what I did before in this diagram. And we can think about the address input, which is not shown here, but you know, it's in the background. We can think about the address input of every one of these chips as a binary value that consists of 2 logical fields. One field can be used to select the exact RAM part on which you want to operate, and the second field can select the very register within this RAM part that you want to affect by either reading or writing something into this register. So taken together, these two tricks can enable you to build RAM devices of arbitrary length. And you use MUX and DMUX gates in order to affect this hierarchical addressing scheme that I just described. So once again, you have here enough tips to enable you to complete the implementation on your own using HDL. So this basically completes the construction of the RAM devices, and we move on to construct the last chip in this project, which is something completely different. It's a program counter, which is just a fancy name for a counter. It's not a fancy name. It's called program counter because later on in the overall construction of our computer, it will serve as a program counter, but effectively it's just a counter. It has an input value, it has an output value, and three control bits. Now, the overall behavior of this counter is somewhat elaborate. We discussed it when we talked about counters before. I want just to emphasize the four most important things about it. This being a counter, we want to be able to set it to zero. We want to be able to set it to some other value, like 17 or 19 or whatever. We want to be able to tell the chip to start counting, to change in every cycle into whatever it was before, plus one. And in some cases, we want to tell it perhaps to stop counting and freeze, so to speak. So what you have to do is to come up with the right functionality, the gate logic that affects every one of these four operations. It turns out that you can do it using a register chip, an incrementer chip, and a bunch of other logic gates that were previously described. So taken together, this is what you have to do in project three. As usual, you go to the NAND to Tetris website and you will find the project webpage with lots of additional operational details. Once again, I want to emphasize for the third time in this course that if you have downloaded the course software suite, there's no need to download anything in addition. This is just for documentation purposes, and you already have all the necessary files on your computer in the directory project/03, and you have your hardware simulator, and you're set to go and build all these chips on your own. As usual, it makes sense to consult these resources when necessary. And finally, all the best practice advice that was given in previous projects is relevant here as well, so you might as well read it before you set out to build the project. And in addition, as usual, you will have to use chips that you implemented in previous projects, and as I explained before, the best practice is to ignore your HDL implementations and use the built-in implementations instead. Finally, there's one more point that I'd like to emphasize on this project, and that is that the HDL files of this project are stored in two separate directories called A and B. And this structure should remain as is. Now, why do we do it? Well, if you recall, our RAM devices are built from smaller RAM parts, and the smaller RAM parts are built from even smaller RAM parts, and it goes on and on. It's like a Russian doll system. And if you take one of these huge RAM chips, let's say a RAM 16K, and put it into the hardware simulator, the simulator begins to evaluate all the chip parts, and it does it in some sort of a recursive drilling downward, all the way down to single bit registers. And it turns out that this can be too much memory or too many objects to handle for the hardware simulator, which is just a humble computer program. And therefore, by putting the registers, by putting these RAM chips in two separate directories, we force the simulator to, at some point, stop using the HDL files and use and start using the Java implementation of these built-in chips. And this will make the implementation, or I'm sorry, this will make the simulation much faster and smoother. So please just leave the directory structure as is, and you're set to go. So this has been a description of what you have to do in Project 3. And as usual, we will now turn to the next unit, in which we give you some broader perspective of the notion of memory devices.